Would you please turn to 475? Must Jesus bear the cross alone? We'll sing 1, 3, and 4. Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. The consecrated cross I'll bear till death shall set me free, and then go home my crown to wear, for there's a crown for me. Upon the crystal pavement down at Jesus' pierced feet, joyful I'll cast my golden crown and his dear name repeat.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Well, this song that the Lord inspired me to write, when I was reading about Mary, when she came to the tomb and found that the stone was rolled away, and I didn't get to sing it at Easter. I call it my Easter song. So I thought it'd be appropriate, since we're having the Lord's Supper, it's all in that time, and it speaks to our hearts. So Mary, with some of the other women, had come to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body with spices. But when they arrived there, they found that the stone was rolled away and he was gone. And Mary sings her song.
Where have they taken my Lord? Oh, where have they taken my Lord? I have come to the sepulchre to anoint him with spices, and have found they have taken him away. To see the stone was rolled away. In his place did sit two strangers, and they said, my Lord and risen. Oh, can you tell me where he's gone today? Oh, where has he gone today? He has risen, he's risen, my Lord has risen today. Alleluia, he's risen, my Master Jesus lives today. Yeah.
turn for a brief moment to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. The Lord's Supper is one of the most special moments of worship that we can ever experience because it's personal, it's one-on-one with the Lord. It's a moment of meditation. It's a moment of fellowship with God. It's a moment of self-examination under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. It is something that Jesus gave to the individual with a choice of whether he or she would choose to observe and celebrate the Lord's Supper. You can follow in your bulletin the simple outline. We're going to just briefly look at it as a moment of preparation. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 and following, Paul gave the protocol and the manual for observing the Lord's Supper. The church of Corinth was a troubled church. It was a church that was on and off, up and down, in and out. They had a lot of problems, and Paul wrote specific instructions to the church of Corinth to correct the conduct and the procedures of their worship. And you'll notice in the bulletin that the Lord's Supper gives us a perspective, a viewpoint that we're led by God from his point of view to see ourselves and then to respond to God as he shows us in the worship and the observance of the Lord's Supper. First of all, you'll find in verse 23 through 26, the Lord's Supper is a look back. Jesus said, "Remember that I died on the cross." We look back in a history of our relationship to the Lord when he gave his life blood in atonement for us. You and I today should look back to the cross and remember that Jesus died for us. Then it's a look forward. You'll notice he said, "Remember as often as you do this till I come again." Jesus is coming again. The signs of time have brought us to the point that the coming of the Lord is very, very near. And Jesus reminded us in the Lord's Supper to look forward with hope to the coming of the Lord again. So in looking back, we have a history to the cross. In looking forward, we have a hope to the throne. Jesus died on the cross, but he rules on the throne. Then there's a look within. In Corinthians, Paul spoke pointedly to the Corinthians, and he said, "Examine yourselves, lest you be reprobates." A reprobate is one that's totally out and away from God. And so the Lord's Supper reminds us not to participate unworthily. Now, the word unworthy does not have anything to do with our imperfections, because the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But it's a procedural word. He says, let all things be done decently and in order. He said, when you observe the Lord's Supper, do it in a worthy manner. The people of Corinth were coming just to get a meal, and they were scrambling one above the other. And Paul said, when you tarry, when you are there, examine yourself, because bad choices have bad consequences. And if you and I unworthily, in an unworthily manner, proceeded to observe the Lord's Supper, instead of making personal preparation to present ourselves to the Lord, then there would be divine correction. I don't know if you've ever had divine correction. I have. And I promise you, when God takes us to the woodshed in a serious manner, it's not funny. He can get your attention. So what Paul was saying to the Corinthian people, you should have a procedure of reverence, because what you're doing has real, real heart meaning. Then, of course, there's the look around. He said, when you come together, look around and see your brothers and sisters. You and I need to see people who are created in the image of God and love them in relation to the Lord Jesus Christ as brothers and sisters. He said, we ought always have to have the right motive. And of course, the motive is to glorify and worship Jesus. And he said, be aware of accountability to God. So you see, the Lord's Supper has real meaning. And if you want to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23, and we'll read through verse 26. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, the cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you in, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he comes. Today, if our men will come forward, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper. And you're invited to look into your heart as your own personal choice, whether you want to participate or not participate. Again, let me take a brief moment to share with you something on the back of your bulletin. This little poem is a true story. A little boy, 5 years old, named Cameron, was a resident at the Baptist Children's Home. One day on the way to school, when we escorted him to the bus, he asked me if I'd tie his shoe. He was a little fellow. And as I knelt down, this is my experience with Cameron. Today we celebrate the Lord's Supper as an act of personal worship, remembrance, and dedication. First, we look back in history to our Lord's death on the cross as a reminder of the great and unspeakable sacrifice of love he gave to us on the cross. Secondly, we look forward in hope to his second coming. Never has a more personal and private moment of opportunity for intimate worship been given to us than in the participation of this ordinance. Yet, it is a public celebration within the body of Christ, the church. It is both at one and the same way a confession of faith and an expression of fellowship. We invite those who believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and want to remember his death and second coming to join us in this special time of worship. Bow with me on your knee before little Cameron, 5 years old, and look into his eye, and what do you see? Barely past the age of 3, his arm in a cast was broken from a fall climbing a tree. He said in soft tones spoken, please, may I ask, would you help me tie my shoe? There, bending upon one knee, I faced him eye to eye. Deep within, I could see, mirrored in his heart, the answer of Jesus in reply, as as he washed the disciples' feet. Today, join us for the worship of the Lord's Supper. And the day of unleavened bread came on the which the Passover must be sacrificed. And he sent Peter and John saying, go and make ready for us the Passover that we may eat. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we make ready? And he said unto them, behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house whereinto he goes. And you shall say unto the master of the house, the teacher said unto you, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room furnished, there make ready. They went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. When the hour was come, he sat down and the apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I shall not eat it until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he received a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I shall not drink from henceforth the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And the cup in like manner after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, even that which is poured out for you. We now come to observe the ordinance of the Lord's Supper, given to celebrate in memory of his broken body and shed blood. It is said that on the night before he was betrayed, at the conclusion of the feast of the Passover, which he and his disciples were celebrating, he took bread and having blessed it, broke it and gave to his disciples and said, this is my body which is given for you. May we pray. Father, as we come to this moment to remember in the symbolism of the broken bread, Jesus' broken, bruised body, as he gave himself on the cross to be our atonement, the sacrificial lamb, we give you thanks. We open our heart to acknowledge you and to praise you and to worship you for the gift of salvation that Jesus has given us in his death on the cross. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, not as the fathers ate and died, he that eats this bread shall live forever. On that same night, our Lord took the cup and, having blessed it, gave to his disciples and said, "This is my blood, which was shed for you." May we pray. Heavenly Father, in this moment we celebrate the life of Jesus, that in death he gave life to us, that in death we might live in him. We praise you, Lord, for that unspeakable gift, the riches of his grace. And we dedicate this moment of worship to his glory, to his name. Amen. And according to the law, I may almost say all things are cleansed with blood, and apart from shedding of blood, there is no remission. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of his Son cleanses us from all sin. After our Lord and his disciples ate the bread and drank the wine, celebrating thus the first supper of our Lord, it is said that they sang a hymn and went out. We want to meet our visitors, and if you would like to stand and sing the hymn of benediction, you can find 387 in the meantime. Mary Ann, you have some precious hearts with you today, and are you going to share them with us or keep them for yourself? Does Brown get his good looks from you or somewhere else? He favors you? Okay. Thank y'all for coming. Let's stand and sing our benediction, 387.
Let's sing verses 1 and 5. Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we shall still